رأيت جسمك الساعات نحتا وتدعوك المنون دعاء صدق ألا يا صاح أنت أريد أنت أراك تحب عرسا ذات خدر أبت طلاقها الأكياس بتا تنام الدهر ويحك في غطيط بها حتى إذا مت انتبهتا فكم ذا أنت مخدوع وحتى متى لا ترعوي عنها وحتى أبا بكر دعوتك لو أجبتا إلى ما فيه حظك لو عقلتا إلى علم تكون به إماما مطاعا إن نهيت وإن أمرتا ويجلو ما بعينك من غشاها ويهديك السبيل إذا ضللتا وتحمل منه في ناديك تاجا ويكسوك الجمال إذا عريتا ينالك نفعه ما دمت حيا ويبقى ذكره لك إن ذهبتا هو العضب المهند ليس ينبو تصيب به مقاتل من أردتا وكنز الله.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على سيدنا محمدٍ وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm your host Kareem Abu Zaid, and this is another edition of the workshop Let's Pray the Prophet's Way. And this is lecture number 2, chapter 2, Brothers and Sisters in Islam. Inshallah, we'll make this quick tonight, so we will get to business right away. So tonight we're doing chapter 2, which is titled The Prophet's Way. You see, we're saying let's pray the Prophet's way, because quite frankly, there are people who pray this Sheikh's way, this Imam's way, this tribe's way, this madhab's way. So we're saying we wanna pray the Prophet's way. That's the title of the chapter, chapter 2 of the book, inshallah. Why are we saying this, brothers and sisters in Islam? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray like you have seen me pray, as you have seen me pray. So we're supposed to pray exactly like the Prophet's way, not any other way, brothers and sisters in Islam. And this is why we're calling it Let's Pray the Prophet's Way, inshallah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, there will be a competition, a contest. There are three prizes already designated to the winners. 1500 the first prize, 750 the second, 500 is the third. One of the brothers from Michigan, our dear brother Ra'fat, Abu Al-Jud, he is the one who donated this amount. And inshallah, we're willing to accept more donations towards more prizes. If we receive more donations, inshallah, we will add more prizes, inshallah. A couple of announcements quickly here. This is what you've been asking. A lot of you have been asking for CMCC virtual weekend school. A lot of you have been asking for this. Arabi, Quran, and Islamic studies. And myself, I'll be teaching the Islamic studies, by the way. every Saturday and Sunday, if you have children, from 10 until 11 Mountain Standard Time. But you have to sign up, because this is not going to be broadcasted on the mainstream, on the public. It has to be private, and it will be, inshallah, on Zoom. So if you want your children to learn Aqeedah, you can, by the way, sign up for individual classes. You can do just Islamic studies with me. There will be Arabic and Quran. So you could actually sign up for one class or two classes if you want. But this is where you can sign, right here. I'm going to leave this on the screen for a minute. So hopefully you can write it down. Where can you sign up your children? We're starting, brothers and sisters in Islam, next week. Saturday and Sunday, the 7th and the 8th. So if you have not signed up yet, you need to move forward with this, inshallah. Because only limited, by the way, only limited slots. So please go ahead and sign, inshallah. Tayyib. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we based this workshop, Let's Pray the Prophet's Way, on a statement by Imam Malik, rahimahullah, Malik ibn Anas, who said that the later part of this ummah, which is us, will not be rectified except by what rectified its first part. And one, we mentioned in the previous lecture that one of the things which we lost is the sweetness of faith. And the second thing, which we're trying to bring back into our lives, is the comfort we find in salah. Remember, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say to Bilal, "O Bilal, make iqamah so that we can find comfort in the salah." Arihna biha ya Bilal. So we're trying to work on that side. And inshallah, with the aqeedah classes, the sweetness of faith may be regained, inshallah, brothers and sisters in Islam. In the last lecture, we presented to you that this earlier generation of the ummah, the first three steamed or braised generations, in hadith al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي, the best of the ummah is my sahaba, then those who follow them, then those who follow them. Three generations. Imagine one person only did not pray well. He did not pray correctly. One person. Subhanallah, all the ummah learned about him. Amazing. Amazing. The man who prayed badly. Then we ask this question, how come many Muslims are not praying correctly and they do not receive the same attention this one man received at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You see, we're trying to build up. And we suggested four reasons. Four reasons. Number one, we're trying to be polite. Here they are, if you want to look at them. The first white one here, out of politeness. Reason number two, many Muslims themselves are uncertain whether the way they pray is correct or not. I tell you, and this reason is so true. A lot of Muslims, they pray and they don't know whether, you know, none of them, many of them, let's be fair here, a lot of them learned, but many of them did not go through a workshop or a class. to learn how to pray. They basically saw the parents, community members praying, and they pray. So if you're uncertain about the way that you pray, when you see something, someone else praying differently or different to you, there is no way you're going to correct him. Now you're actually going to question your own salah. But if you learned, you will step up and you will correct him. You're getting that. Reason number three, a lot of the people who know how to pray, they assume that it is an obligation upon them only to pray correctly. But seeing others not praying correctly, it doesn't matter. As long as I'm praying correctly, properly, then I'm not supposed to correct other people, which is wrong too. Reason number four, which takes us to our class today, a lot of Muslims follow school of thoughts once it comes to praying. Follow certain imams, Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali, and others. And by the way, brothers and sisters in Islam, subhanallah, living in the West, make this a big problem. Why? Because living in America or living in Europe, you end up with a pool of Muslims from all over the Muslim world. So the brothers who came from India and Pakistan, for example, I'm using this for example, and other parts of the Muslim world, they been brought up in madhab al-Imam Abi Hanifa rahimahullah. The brothers who came from the peninsula, they are more into the Hanbali, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi. The brothers who came from Egypt, Palestine, Syria, more into the Shafi'i. The brothers who came from Morocco and West Africa, more into the Maliki. So imagine you bring all those people into one masjid. Then it becomes a cause of disunity. Now, what happens in our Muslim communities here in America? You end up with imams who are strong enough to deal with the issue, to let the people know that we're all supposed to pray the Prophet's way. So let's unite on whoever has the evidence from these imams. That is the ideal, but challenging, not simple. It takes wisdom, it takes endurance, perseverance, and it takes education of the community. But here is the second solution, which is not very good, that you end up with a masjid which is only for the Pakistani, meaning the Hanafi, only for the Arabs, meaning the Shafi'i or Hanbali, only for the West African, meaning the Maliki. So a madhab driven congregation, which is not good. That is why, brothers and sisters in Islam, a sign of success in a masjid, that when you enter, you find people from different parts of the Muslim world praying together the same way, and they are uniting on the Prophet's way. Now, for the benefit of addressing this issue, brothers and sisters in Islam, inshallah, I compiled the whole chapter, which is chapter 2 in the book, inshallah, which hopefully will come out soon for you to, as a reference, is we called it the Prophet's Way. What do we mean by the Prophet's Way? Let's just, here are the elements or the items I want to address in this chapter. Most probably I will address just the first and the second. First of all, the authority of the Sunnah. The authority of the Prophet's way. Obstacle of adherence to the Prophet's way. What stands in the way of following, adhering to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we came up to is it obligatory to follow a certain madhab? Can students of knowledge do absolute taqleed, which is blind following of a certain madhab? What is the stance of the four imams on blind following? Did they command their followers to follow them blindly? Why did they differ in the first place? Imagine we're going to address all these beautiful, beautiful points. So let's deal with the first one, brothers and sisters in Islam. The authority of the Sunnah. You cannot imagine the authority of the Prophet's way. You cannot imagine the amount of evidence we have in the Quran and in the Sunnah to establish Hujjiyatu Sunnah, the authority of the Sunnah, of the Hadith, of the Prophet's way, that we all are commanded to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'll share with you some. Muslims must understand that when they state, you see, when you say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, you're saying what? La ma'buda bihaqqin illallah. No one is worthy or has the right to be worshipped except Allah. And when you say wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, when you say that, you're saying no one has the right to be followed but Rasulullah. Or anyone who takes you to Rasulullah. You're getting that. So the kalima, the testimony of faith, the universal declaration of faith itself tells you that no one has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worthy of worshipping except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Two, no one has the right to be followed except Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So that's the first one. So don't think that following the Sunnah is an option. Actually, it is an obligation, brothers and sisters in Islam. It has been the trending of some Muslims from time to time to question the authority of the Prophet, Sunnah, doubt the Hadith, which is the body containing his sayings and describing his actions. Sometimes they say it's not accurate. Some people say it's unnecessary. However, the Sunnah is an essential source of Islam. It is not just relevant and necessary. It is the grounds from which we understand how to realize the Quran in our daily lives. There is a consensus amongst the scholars that any Muslim who refuses to accept, obey, and follow the Prophet Sunnah, he's no longer a Muslim. If he does this, be careful. If he does this, what? With knowledge, knowingly, willfully, and with a willful intention. Always, ya ikhwa, when we declare another Muslim to be apostate, we have to always use those two restrictions. Willful intention, he's not forced. In some countries now, if you arrive with a beard, like in Russia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, you're taken to jail. Even though the beard is an act, but now you're forced not to have it. So willful intention must be there, and knowledge that the person is not ignorant, is not doing or abandoning the sunnah out of faulty interpretation. العذر بالتأويل, knowledge يعني. Always we have to throw those two restrictions. It is incumbent upon us to first make sure that the evidence is established against them. And that's what I explained in yellow. Furthermore, brothers and sisters in Islam, the Muslims, let me stop that ticker here. Muslims believe that the Prophet's complete, authentically transmitted teachings are essential, are unessential origin of the religion. You know, Islam is made of Quran and Sunnah. Muhammad ibn Hazm, one of the scholars of this ummah, he said, if someone states that he only accepts the Quran, he becomes a disbeliever, according to the consensus of the Muslims. Hence, to deny any part of the Sunnah is disbelief. However, be careful here. If someone questions the authenticity of one hadith based on evidence, like we have some scholars, like Sheikh Al-Albani authenticated this hadith. Let's say Tirmidhi did not. So they disagreed on the authenticity of one hadith. This does not mean they are not denying the sunnah. But based on a thorough or knowledge, they refused or rejected the hadith because they questioned one of the narrators, for example. So this does not take them out of the fold of Islam. So we have to be very careful with that. So if some scholar says this hadith is weak, and another scholar says this hadith is fabricated, and someone else comes and says, no, this is authentic. So this is, this is an area of disagreement, which is permissible, brothers and sisters in Islam. Because these people, in principle, they don't deny the sunnah. They don't reject the sunnah as a whole. We're really talking about the people who say, no sunnah, not important, unnecessary. What is written here applies to them only, brothers and sisters in Islam. Why does Shaitan loves bid'ah? Sufyan al-Thawri mentioned innovations are more beloved to Shaitan than sins, major sins. Since a sin may be repented from, but the innovator believes that he's doing the right thing. That's why Shaitan loves bid'ah more than Shaitan would love to get a Muslim to indulge in committing innovations in Islam than committing major sins. Understand why? Because the person who does the bid'ah, the person who does the mawlid, he believes he's doing the right thing. That's why he will be willing to fight you. Mawlid is, you say mawlid, and they get angry and upset at you. Wait a minute, can we talk? Can we discuss it? You know, can we have a adult talk here? You know, grown-ups, come on, leave. They will not. Because what? They believe they are doing the right thing. But a person who's committing a major sin, you know, he sits in a lecture or something, and the scholar or the imam or the khutbah, he reminds them with tawbah, He repents. You're getting that. That is why the second item in Shaitan's agenda for the human race is bid'ah. You see, if Shaitan fails to make you fall into the traps of shirk, which is la ilaha illallah, he will strive to make you fail Muhammadur Rasulullah. You see, that's where he begins. La ilaha illallah. If you're solid on tawheed, then he's going to come after Muhammadur Rasulullah, and he tries to take you away from the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another reason why Shaitan loves the bid'ah, because any act which does not meet sincerity, the two conditions are fulfilled, sincerity and adherence is not accepted. So if you do an act of worship without being sincere, doing it for the sake of this world, to show off, or to earn a status, or to earn money, or fame, is not going to be accepted. Also, if the act is ritualistic, is an act of worship, a ritual, and you do not do it in accordance with the Prophet's way, it will not be accepted. So Shaitan is happy with Muslims being busy with doing things, doing acts of worship, which will not be accepted. What is the evidence for that statement? Hadith Aisha radiallahu anha, wal hadith fi al-Bukhari wa Muslim, qawlun nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad. Anyone who introduces an act of worship into the religion which I did not approve of, it will be rejected. Wal riwayat Muslim, من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Whoever acts, it will not be accepted. It will be rejected. This is why Shaitan loves bid'ah more than sunnah. As a matter of fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, brothers and sisters in Islam, warned us against those people. Hadith is authentic. Soon there will come a time that a man will be reclining on his pillow, and when one of my hadith is narrated, he will say, "Alayna bi kitabillah," the book of Allah is sufficient. We do not need that between us and you. Whatever it states permissible, we will take it as permissible. And whatever the Quran states to be forbidden, we will take it as forbidden. Here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, verily, whatever the Messenger of Allah has forbidden is like what Allah has forbidden. I love the description of this man. Imagine he's reclining, he's laying down in a sofa, meaning he's comfortable with the world. You need to understand, brothers and sisters in Islam, the hadith or the sunnah is the practical application of the Quran. The sunnah gets us working. You know, the details of the dua, the details of the actions is really in the sunnah. So when you reject the sunnah, there is only, tell me, where do you find the Quran five times, salah? Five. Not just, let's not get into the number of rak'ahs or what to say in each rak'ah. Bring me one evidence from the Quran where it says we have to pray five times. Yes, there is hafidhu ala salawati. Keep up with the prayers, but not the number five. This is why the people who are Qur'ani, by the way, they believe you only have to pray twice. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ طَرَفَيِ النَّهَارِ وَزُلَفًا مِّنَ اللَّيْلِ. They tell you we follow the Qur'an. So we only pray Maghrib, Fajr, طَرَفَيِ النَّهَارِ, the two ends of the day. And there is another salah which is voluntary called Zulaf, Salat al-Zulaf, which is at night. But they don't pray five times. Why? Because they don't accept the Sunnah. And we're not talking about how to pray even. That's you're getting that. So you see, the Quran gets you to work. That is why the Prophet ﷺ described this man who is rejecting the Sunnah. How? متكئاً على أريكته. He is reclining on his sofa, on his bench, on his couch, on his bed. He's content. He's happy with the little the Quran details, because the rest is in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. What are the obstacles which comes between us and following the Sunnah? This is number one here. We only follow the Quran. I mentioned four obstacles. Inshallah, let's quote them for you. Some claim that they only follow and obey the Quran and nothing else. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ وَمَا أَتَاكُمْ رَسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنُهُ فَانْتَهُوا. So in the Quran itself, Allah is telling you, obey the messenger. ولذلك Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is the one who narrated hadith al-Nams. لعن الله النامصة والمتنمصة. Allah curses the woman who blocks and the one who is being blocked. So one of the ladies came to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and he said, I read the Quran from Al-Fatiha to Nas. I didn't see this. Where are you getting this from? He said, bring me the Quran. And he brought her Surah Al-Hashr. What did you read here? وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the messenger commands you to do, do. And whatever the messenger bans you from, do not do. You're getting that. Another reason, they say the authority of the Prophet is void because he died. So some Muslims, they believe that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had an authority. Yes, so they accept that. And this is where you clothe falsehood with the truth. Oh yeah, the Prophet had an authority, but while he's alive. But after his death, we go to the Quran, which is wrong. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or named the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be a universal messenger to all of mankind until the day of judgment. So the fact that he is the only messenger until the day of judgment, this in itself an evidence that his sharia, his way, will never be abrogated. We actually believe that Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend to implement his sharia. Sharia of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So we're done with that. Number three, the hadith has defects. And that's a famous one. Those who deny the sunnah, they allegedly claim that it has defects. And it was documented later, and this is wrong. To respond to this, brothers and sisters in Islam, and inshallah in the book you're going to read more details, we have scholars who simply established the science of hadith, where you look at the text, which is the matn, and verify it and compare it with other texts, whether from another chain of narrators or the text of the Quran. And based on this, label the text to be authentic or not. They also looked at the chain of transmitters, the narrators of the hadith, from the Prophet ﷺ all the way until the individual who compiled the book, whether it is al-Bukhari, whether it is Muslim, al-Tirmidhi, al-Nasa'i. And they compiled a biography for each narrator. Where did he live? What did he do? Was he known to be a liar or trustworthy? Was he known to be a good hafiz, good memory, or he mixes? So we have a science to do this, brothers and sisters in Islam. And then we come to the last point, which is going to take us to the subject of madhab. I don't pray the Prophet's way. I don't follow the sunnah because I'm following a madhab. And this is very interesting once it comes to the salah, brothers and sisters in Islam. Inshallah, in the next lecture, we're going to discuss the following 5 points. Is it obligatory to follow a certain madhab? Can students of knowledge do absolute madhab, meaning blind following, someone who has the knowledge? What is the stance or the stand, basically, or the opinion of the four imams on blindly following them? Why did the imams differ to begin with? And where can we strike the balance? Because there is a balance there. There are people, brothers, that there is no way that we can actually change them. They are bro madhab. What should we do? And all of this, inshallah, hopefully in the next lecture, inshallah, and bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, by the way, this Sunday, we're hosting one of the experts in the field of hadith, Sheikh Farooq Post, and actually we chose this subject. So I'm happy that you guys are going to get a taste of this on Sunday, inshallah. But this is all, inshallah, for today. Here is questions. Please record these questions because a lot of the questions on the test, on the quiz on January 31st, if you want to win the prizes, are going to come from here. Mention 2 evidence to establish the authority of the Sunnah. Did the Prophet warn us against the rejectors of the Sunnah? I only follow the Quran, how to respond. The Hadith has defects, how to respond. Mention the 4 obstacles of adherence, which we mentioned, inshallah. Again, let's announce, brothers and sisters in Islam, a lot of you have been talking about offering a virtual weekend school. I will be actually teaching classes 10 o'clock Saturday, 10 o'clock Sunday. I will be teaching them Islamic studies, but you need to sign up. The link is right here. We're going to have Islamic studies, Arabic and Quran, a weekend Islamic school. Arabic, you could actually register for individual classes too. I think they made it like $100 for the whole thing and $35 for each class, brothers and sisters in Islam. And by the way, money is never an issue. If you're unable, inshallah, we can always find a way to help you, inshallah. But sign up your children, brothers and sisters in Islam. Help us out, brothers and sisters in Islam. Start these programs because we're hiring teachers, we're hiring people who are putting together a website for you. So please help us. Let's teach your children how to love the Quran, how to love the language of the Quran, and how to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Tayyib, I don't know if you have any questions or not, but the phone lines are open. If you're interested in asking questions, I don't mind. I still have some time. So here's the phone line right here in front of you, brothers and sisters in Islam. Let me see if I have any questions on the chat, which I don't see here. Okay, let me see. So I do not see straight path. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So let's put this here. Straight path here. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. سيستر أم محمد وعليكم السلام. تامر المصري from Canada وعليكم السلام. سامي يوسف وعليكم السلام. أجي سو وعليكم السلام. سيستر رحيمة وعليكم السلام. سيستر نورة وعليكم السلام. وعليكم السلام توماس. Good to have you توماس. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. هاي توماس. وعليكم السلام توماس. MS أبو بكر محمد المحجوب right here. Good to have you brother المحجوب. وعليكم السلام. عبد الرحمن حسن وعليكم السلام عبد الرحمن. فياز رومي وعليكم السلام عبد الرحمن حسن for this life. عليكم السلام. ألفا زهرة وعليكم السلام. May Allah bless you sister ألفا. I'm sorry فاطمة. True. May Allah reward you as well. محمد عاشق وعليكم السلام. أوكي جمال حسين وعليكم السلام. ربيعة وعليكم السلام. أحمد أدب وعليكم السلام. فكيمة I think موسى وعليكم السلام. إمام بكر إمام زيد وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. Please put English subtitles. English subtitles. I don't know what do you mean by that. Okay, Fatima. Okay, I don't think we have any questions, so we're good for tonight, inshallah. I don't see any questions here. Okay, I'm going through. Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Will you be able to discuss about wudu? Yes, yes, yes. We're going to go into salah. We haven't gone into the subject yet. Inshallah. Yes, wudu, of course. One of the conditions of salah is wudu. Tayyib, I think we're all good for tonight. Jazakumullahu khairan, brothers and sisters in Islam. I see you tomorrow, inshallah. The same time, by the way, 8 o'clock is better for me because of the time. We're going to be doing the Maqasidic Tafsir tomorrow, 8 o'clock, inshallah. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
فت فؤادك الأيام فتا وتنحت جسمك الساعات نحتا وتدعوك المنون دعاء صدق ألا يا صاح أنت أريد أنت أراك تحب عرسا ذات خدر أبت طلاقها الأكياس بتا تنام الدهر ويحك في غطيط بها حتى إذا مت انتبهتا فكم ذا أنت مخدوع وحتى متى لا ترعوي عنها وحتى أبا بكر دعوتك لو أجبتا إلى ما فيه حظك لو عقلتا إلى علم تكون به إماما مطاعا إن نهيت وإن أمرتا ويجلو ما بعينك من غشاها ويهديك السبيل إذا ضللتا وتحمل منه في ناديك تاجا ويكسوك الجمال إذا عريتا ينالك نفعه ما دمت حيا ويبقى ذكره لك إن ذهبتا هو العضب المهند ليس ينبو تصيب به مقاتل من أردتا وكنز لا تخاف عليه لصا خفيف الحمل يوجد حيث